Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to the first physics colloquium of this semester. And of course, it is my pleasure to welcome our esteemed speaker of today, Dr. Linda Tacconi. Linda received her PhD from UMass in Massachusetts in 1988. Then she went for a couple of years to Holland, Twingelo, where it's sort of the place where all radio astronomer gurus pass at some point in their career. Linda then moved in 1991 to the Max Planck Institute für Extraterrestrische Physik in Munich, and she has been there since then, becoming, of course, a senior scientist there, and practically more than that, becoming a pillar of their entire institute. From there, Linda has pioneered the infrared exploration of the universe beyond our own galaxy, opening really to our understanding the complex physics of transformation of molecular gas into stars in external galaxies, down to these very days, for example, with her most recent discoveries published in Nature's of molecular gas in primordial galaxies, really at the frontier of our current technological observability. When I think of Linda, the word frontier comes in mind. This word really characterizes, I would say, defines her career. All throughout, she has written more than 180 articles with more than 1,000 citations and counting. But for us who know her well, actually, Linda is famous for something else. I really would think that Linda is famous for being our role model of scientific exploration and scientific achievement. So I'd like to ask you to welcome Linda to our physics colloquium and to the ETA.
Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction, Marcel. I don't know if I can live up to that, but I'd like to thank all the organizers as well for having me come down to Zurich. I come down every so often because we're working with people here, but it's the first time I'm coming down to talk to, you know, the entire department. So it's a bit overwhelming, actually. So what I would like to tell you about today is some work that we're doing together as well with people here in Zurich. I will go into quite a bit of background, but I figured I would start by saying that the results that I'm going to show you today really are the result of a big team effort. I'm giving this talk, but certainly my two co-leaders in Garching, Natasha Förster-Schreiber and Reinhard Genzel, I think would probably give equally or better talks on this topic. And then we have two very good teams. So I'm going to talk about observations that we're making of early universe galaxies in the near infrared, and our team there is twinned together with the team here in Zurich, including Marcella and Simon Lilly and Yingji Peng, congratulations, who just did his defense, and also Sandro Takella and various other students and postdocs who are working with us very closely on the near-infrared data. So they know all this already. And then we have a second team who's working on the cold gas, the molecular gas, and that's again an international team of mostly these people, where we're using the telescope in southern France to make our observations. So what I hope to give you in the next 45 minutes or so is an overview of what we think we know about how galaxies form and evolve, and then how specifically we're targeting some of the questions of the physics of the galaxy formation through what we call in situ measurements, that is resolve measurements, where we try to go in the smallest spatial scales that we can reach with the current technology. So for the people who aren't used to this topic, apologies to the astronomers who are used to this topic. What we think we understand pretty well about galaxy formation is the initial stages, actually, at least from a theoretical perspective, is that we know that there's this hierarchical merging of dark matter halos in the early universe, and then from these merging halos, baryons from these halos collapse and cool into things that eventually become galaxies. So we see this buildup of structures in the early universe, and then various complicated procedures, which people like to refer to often as gastrophysics, happen such that galaxies form and take shape through different processes, whether it be through slow accretion from these halos, or whether it be more catastrophic events like taking two massive galaxies and slamming them together. And there had been, up until recently, quite a bit of debate as to which of these mechanisms really produces galaxies that we see today. So there's an interplay from this hierarchical merging into this sort of messy stuff, which is where I'm going to spend the rest of this talk, into what we know we see locally, which is the modern Hubble sequence of galaxies. So that's sort of the general picture. The questions are, what happens here? Which of these processes is playing the major role? How do galaxies then, what happens in the early universe? We know that lots of galaxies also have fairly energetic events from star formation or from black hole growth, and they then spew out large amounts of gas. What happens to that gas? So these are the kinds of questions that I'm going to try to address. Now, there are basically two ways that you can do this. One is you get as many statistics as you possibly can, and this is what lots of people do, and you assemble what we've called the cosmic backgrounds, and you can break these up into individual sources. And of course, the HST has been absolutely critical for us in the optical region to be able to identify thousands, millions of early universe galaxies. But that's in the optical wavelength, and what you see are things that are more or less formed. And then in the submillimeter, you trace the colder side of galaxy formation. That's stuff that tends to be about 10 to 50 Kelvin, and this is stuff that's often obscured by dust, and you just don't see it. In the submillimeter, this is very early days, and I will show you some things later on. What this is tracing mostly is more the obscured side of star formation and galaxy formation, but at much, much poorer spatial resolution than the beautiful images that you see coming from HST. Then in the far infrared, we have two important space missions. Herschel in the roughly 100 to 300 micron regime was a European satellite that's just in its last months now. And then a few years ago, Spitzer, which was a US-led mission in the mid-infrared, which give you an assessment of the calorimetric star formation indicators, if you will. So they sort of measure really the total luminosity, the total energy outputs of these things. And then, of course, at the highest energies, the wonderful X-ray satellites that are up there give you lots of information about the energetic processes associated with black holes. And so through these big missions that make large surveys, you can assemble very good samples from which to study galaxies. So what do we know from sort of the global perspective? That's what I want to start with first. So what we know, and actually this is a field that was really pioneered by Simon Lilly here, what we know is if you measure an indication of star formation in the universe, and you measure as you go back in time, so look back time, what astronomers like to call redshift. So here, what you see is that the star formation density, or here luminosity density, increases from the local universe as up to a redshift of about 1, and then sort of flattens off, and at very, very early times may drop again, but that's a topic I don't have time to get into today. But there's this part of space here between redshifts of 1 and 3 or so, when the universe was roughly 20, on average about 20% its current age, where this is what we sometimes refer to as the heyday of galaxy formation, of galaxy assembly. And you know, there's a lot of activity there. That's also where the peak of active galactic nuclei happens, of quasars. There's lots of activity going on in this part of the universe. And as I mentioned before, one of the things what we're trying to understand, and the rest of this talk basically deals with studies of galaxies at these epochs. So in this main epoch of galaxy formation. And one of the things that many of the surveys have been trying to assess is which of these major processes, this more violent slamming together big things in a more hierarchical way, or this more continuous, slower accretion, including some, you know, accreting little things, some smaller already assembled galaxies from the halo, followed by some gravitational instabilities in the forming galaxy. Which of these processes plays the dominant role? Now, what led people to think that it's probably mergers is that when you look at this kind of luminosities, in the local universe, these objects that astronomers have lots of horrible terms for objects, and so there's this thing called ultra-luminous infrared galaxies, or ULIRGs. What we know from our studies of the local universe is that in order to get something in the local universe up to this kind of a luminosity, what you need is a major merger. And people automatically then just extended that, so this must be an important process in high redshift. But what I'm going to, show you in the rest of the time is that there's a big difference between a galaxy locally and a galaxy in this epoch. And that difference is how much material there is that's still not yet in stars. So this reservoir for star formation. And that's what, you know, that I think is the big difference. And so actually what we think more now is that the bulk of the galaxies, a lot of the star formation and assembly is actually happening in this more continuous or quiescent type process. So if you think of that more as sort of an equilibrium, you could think of it as an equilibrium situation where you have these various things. And so the amount of material that's there to continue to form the stars, which after all are the essence of a galaxy, is basically an interplay between three different processes. One is the accretion rate, which from various observations of large-scale structure and also from theoretical models, we think we understand that it goes as roughly the dark matter halo mass, and the accretion rate goes up as a function of look-back time or redshift in that way. Then you have the amount of material that's forming stars, so that's taken out. And then you also have minus some stuff that goes back into the reservoir. And then you have the stuff that, because of star formation or black hole formation, that ultimately is blown out of the galaxy in very powerful winds. So it's the interplay of these stuff coming in, stuff getting locked up into stars, and stuff going out that basically regulates how much stuff you can, how you can evolve in the future. So it's a much more equilibrium type situation. This actually turns out to be the case, we think. And how we know that is that most stars, there's a very well-defined relationship, and this has really, again, been driven by a lot of the work done here. There's a well-defined relationship, basically, at all redshifts between the star formation rate and the stellar mass. This is what's called, in astronomical terms, the main sequence of star formation. Now it's just become sort of a new term. And so you see a fairly well-defined relationship observationally between the star formation rate, that is the rate that a galaxy, a young galaxy, is turning its gas into stars as a function of its stellar mass, up to some stellar mass. And now there are some things that are outliers above this main sequence. And these are what I alluded to before. These are most likely in the local universe, these dusty mergers. And in high redshift, there are these things called submillimeter galaxies, which are very obscured galaxies that are forming stars at about 1,000 solar masses per year. Now, just as a benchmark, a galaxy like the Milky Way is forming stars at a few solar masses per year. So what you also see then is that as you go to high redshift, the average galaxy that's forming stars is forming stars an order of magnitude higher than a galaxy in the local universe. So we have this main sequence of star formation, and we have these outliers. And then the most luminous things, now this is not necessarily because of star formation rate, we have the bright things like quasars, these super luminous things that are mostly driven by supermassive black holes and output from supermassive black holes. The other thing we know from these big surveys is that the galaxies, if you acquire huge samples, as the Sloan survey in the local universe has done, or the Cosmos survey at high redshift, is that you find that if you take a measure of star formation versus stellar mass, you find that galaxies basically form two different populations. There are the blue, the star-forming galaxies, which is what I'm going to be talking about for the rest of this talk, and then there are these things sometimes called red and dead, or just dead galaxies, things that have somehow, for whatever reason, stopped forming stars. These things are very structurally different. Star-forming galaxies, then, we know in the local universe, tend to look like the Milky Way. They have big disks. They have rotating disks. They have they have a central a spheroidal component or a bulge, but they have most of the stars are formed in these extended disks. And then the redder, deader population tends to be more just the spheroidal types. The disks are not so prominent. They don't have any obvious ongoing star formation. So they're or very little. I shouldn't say none. So there are these two populations. And so one of the questions is, what keeps a galaxy on the main sequence? And the second question is, how does this galaxy eventually become, what causes a star-forming galaxy to ultimately go dead? And those are, by the way, still very open questions. So at high redshift, we're also now finding, we're getting these great samples, and what we're finding is that at high redshift, just like in local universe, galaxies that are forming stars, also the majority of them tend to have fairly extended, nicely rotating disks. Now this is shown here in a compendium from Stein Wautz, who's a postdoc in our group, where he has taken in the local universe, redshift 1 and sort of redshift 2, he's measured the light profiles in thousands and thousands of galaxies. And what a light profile tells you is basically the distribution of the stars. And if a galaxy is rotating in sort of a regular fashion, you expect, roughly speaking, that the light profile is exponential. That is, astronomers have this thing called a Sirzak index. All you need to know is that the things in black are more disk-like, the things in red are more spheroidal-like, and what you see is that this line, which indicates the star formation main sequence, it all redshifts, is dominated mostly by disk-like things. And so that's just, I show you down here, an illustrated picture of three examples in the local universe at redshift 1 and at redshift 2. Now, those galaxies look very different, actually, right? The local universe, the beautiful Whirlpool galaxy, you see beautiful spiral arms. At redshift 1, you often see this already as well. But it's redshift 2, because a lot of the surveys are done in the optical, which remember, then that's rest frame ultraviolet shifted to optical, or in the infrared, where which is rest frame optical, then red shifted into the infrared, you often see things that have lots of you know, they look clumpy. They look much, they don't look as nice and regular as a local galaxy. And that's largely because they are clumpier, but that's also because there's a lot of dust and we're just not seeing everything. What we also know is that the bulk of these disk galaxies, if you study the calorimetric star formation rates from these galaxies, from large samples of these galaxies from Herschel, what you find out is that these outliers only account for about 10% of the star formation that's happening at this high redshift. That the bulk of the star formation is actually sitting on these main sequence. And this, until a few years ago, was not yet known. Okay, so that's sort of in 10 minutes what we think we know about galaxies from a global perspective. So the rest of the talk, what I want to then say, that this one approach is to have these thousands and thousands of galaxies, and you assemble single measurement kind of information and try to derive what you think is a consensus picture of star formation and galaxy formation. And then what you can also do, though, is then from those surveys, go back and select wisely, select as best you can, typical objects with different masses, different parameters, and try to constrain parameter space, and then go at a few of those with the best technology that you have, and then try to understand on the smallest scales. Now, for an astronomer studying something at 20% of the age of the universe, a small scale is for us 3 or 4 kiloparsecs, so 15,000-20,000 light years. But so for most of the physicists I know, they're going, oh my God, I'm going to tune out now if this is what she thinks is small scale. But it's what we can do right now. So there are two tools, and I alluded to this in the very beginning, that we're using. One is Symphony with the European Southern Observatory's Very Large Telescope in Chile. We're using a technique called integral field spectroscopy, where we get an image of a galaxy, but then we also get, in the third axis, we get information about the wavelength. So you can get information about different spectral lines, or within a spectral line, you can measure the Doppler shift and get very important information about the kinematics of the galaxies. So the survey that I'm going to talk to you about is, there are two surveys, basically. One is called the SIN survey, the newer one, ZC-SIMF, which we've been doing, as I said, in collaboration with people here, where we've, from these bigger surveys of galaxies, selected 120 or so galaxies by now and followed them up with these more deep observations in the near-infrared. Now, in the near-infrared, which is around two microns where we're observing, what that gives us is a handle of one of the brightest hydrogen emission lines, the Balmer-Alpha line, which is redshifted out into the K-band, or in 2 microns, at these times. So we have the near-infrared. And the H-alpha line basically gives you an estimate of current star formation, and it's tracing gas that's about 10,000 Kelvin, so what we would consider pretty hot, but what astronomers consider warm. Then we're supplementing that with millimeter observations of the colder component, the molecular gas. Now, it's just early days now. Huge new interferometer is just coming online, also in Chile. It's called ALMA. It will ultimately have 66 antennas located in the northern Chilean Atacama Desert at an altitude of 5,000 meters. But up until now, we've done very well to assemble a survey of these main sequence galaxies with an interferometer that we have located right here in Europe, run by the IROM Observatory, and this telescope is 6 15-meter antennas located in the south of France. Now, as radio astronomers, we learned a long time ago something that the optical astronomers can't do, is that we don't like to build big telescopes. We have the ability to synthesize a big telescope, by using interferometry keep adding more and more antennas, which are relatively speaking, inexpensive way to do it. And you can synthesize very high spatial resolution using this technique. And so you're sensitive to the spatial scales that of the longest, the widest separation of your two antennas. And why we can do that is because in the radio, we're allowed to amplify our signal as much as we want. And so you can amplify a very weak signal in the process, and then you correlate this signal, take the Fourier transform, and you get very beautiful images. Not as beautiful as Space Telescope, but ALMA will be able to do that in the future. So we have two tracers, one that traces current star formation and one that traces the potential for star formation. And we're lagging way behind here because we haven't had the sensitivity up until now to really probe in the same detail. So here's what we do. As you know, from the ground, we are plagued by the Earth's atmosphere. I mean, we have clouds, obviously, but there's something that to astronomers who are trying to get to the highest spatial resolution, it's actually as bad as clouds, and that's the fact that the atmosphere causes things to scintillate. And so this is what you get in one of our typical star-forming galaxies from the SIN survey after observing for 4 hours on one of the most technologically advanced telescopes in the world, the VLT. Now, this is the H alpha emission line. You get a fair amount of information, but what you then can do is either find a bright star nearby to track on, and then you can correct to correct for this atmospheric turbulence, or if you don't have one, which although it looks like the sky is full of stars, you'd be surprised. It's very rare to find a bright star near your object. In fact, it's a 1 in 100 chance or so that we've been able to do that, or even worse. And so what the VLT has then is an artificial star that they shoot up into the sodium layer of the atmosphere with a laser that you use as an artificial star, and you track on that. And what you can do then is improve the information you get and the spatial scales that you're sensitive to from basically a typical good night at the VLT gives you a so-called seeing of about a half of an arc second, or a little bit worse, actually. So at the redshifts that we're talking about, that's several kiloparsecs. You can improve that down to about 0.1, 0.2 arc seconds, which is not quite as good as HST, but it's pretty good. And so with integral field spectroscopy, then, not only can you get this some image, but then you can look at different Doppler settings, basically, at different velocities, and you see the stuff coming towards you here in the blue, and you see the stuff on the other side of the galaxy then moving away from you. And you can observe this systematically. And from these images, at each velocity, you can determine quite a bit about the kinematics of a galaxy. Now, what you get, this is again the sum image of the H-alpha emission. Now, what you get from these integral field maps is basically at each point, not just the emission, but you get a mean velocity and the dispersion about that mean. And that gives you quite a bit of information about the dynamical state of the galaxy. So if you have, for example, here, a model galaxy which has a nice exponential light profile, much too simple, we're never going to see that, but and you look at something that's just regularly rotating, it along the line of sight, what you tend to see are mean velocities that form this spider light, what we call the spider diagram. So this is a clear signature that you've got something that has a lot of angular momentum that's dominated by this kind of motion, rather than something that's more pressure supported by the dispersion. What you also see then is that the dispersion, the velocity dispersion, just basically due to the fact that you have limited resolution, tends to peak in the center because you're combining lots of different, you have lots of velocity crowding very close to the center due to this rotation. Okay? So that's, this is, it's not obvious to people who are not used to thinking about this all the day, that you know, what this would tell you. Because this is a clear signature that something is in relatively stable rotation. So what can you get out of that? If you take the combination of a flux, of an H alpha flux, which gives you a star formation rate, because we know that this hydrogen emission, you can only excite that around new young stars, you can get a rate at which the stars are forming. But you can also get a measure, if you know how something's in just simple rotation, you just use the virial theorem and get a dynamical mass. And this is a very powerful tool when you know that something is relatively stable. And we know then that in this galaxy, we're measuring a dynamical mass of something that's almost as massive as the Milky Way. So we have a dynamical mass of about 10 to the 11 solar masses. You form what's called a rotation curve, and we know that these flatten out. So you also get a probe of what the dark matter halo and the mass of the dark matter halo might be. So you can get an equivalent circular velocity, and you can get a measure of this pressure component, this velocity dispersion, which we see that this kind of a velocity dispersion of 50 to 100 kilometers per second means that there's a disk, and it's definitely rotating, but there's a lot of turbulence in this disk. And this is in stark contrast to what we see in, say, the Milky Way, where the velocity dispersion is only a few kilometers per second to a 10 kilometers per second. So we see rotation that's very similar to the Milky Way, but with much, much higher dispersion. So that already tells us then that this is a disk, but it's a puffy disk, it's a turbulent disk. It's not quite settled yet. But that's something to keep in mind, and that's what we can get from just making this one observation. So we were able to then do this for 120 galaxies and measure the velocity fields in what's called seeing limited mode in most of these galaxies. And you see that you can quantify then the motions based on how regular the spider diagram looks. And you can apply a quantitative assessment in a procedure called kinemetry to say whether or not something has a regular rotation type velocity field, or whether it's got something that's more chaotic, which would be more indicative of a merging system. So then from the kinematics, you can then go back to the original question and say, is this something that's regularly rotating, or is this something, do I have a key kinematically now, not just looking at the fact that it looks chaotic, because we know that can mislead you. So kinematically, does this look like it could be undergoing a major galaxy merger? And so sometimes you do see that there are kinematic, chaotic velocity fields. We see in more than two-thirds of the cases, though, that these velocity fields are more regular. And then we also then, and in this way, can characterize this rotational component to this dispersion or this turbulent component. And you can then see that there are these galaxies over here, which seem to have some rotation, but also have a large component of dispersion. Now, if you go back and look at these tend to be much smaller. If you go back and look at these then with adaptive optics, which we now have been able to do in 30 such cases, 30 of our 120 cases, this is very time consuming. It takes roughly one night per object on an 8-meter. And that is very, it's hard to get that much time. We were fortunate in that we had a leg up because our group built the integral field spectrometer, and ESO has a great system where then you get some time back for doing this experiment for them. And so with this guaranteed time, we were able then to invest large amounts of observing time. So if you go back with adaptive optics, as I explained, you then can see that some of these also then become show clear signs of rotation. So you could see that this is a fairly powerful tool to measure the properties of these galaxies. This is what we call refer to as in situ observations. So what about the cold component? I told you again already that we're using the IRAM interferometer, which is located south of Grenoble, about 2 hours south of Grenoble, on a high flat plateau in the Southern Alps, where there are 6 antennas that can be moved along these tracks to give you spatial resolutions. Now, with this system, we're only able to get down to just maybe a half of an arc second is about as good as we can do. But with ALMA, we'll get much. We'll do yet better. We're still somewhat sensitivity limited because we have 6 antennas only, and so we're probing the most massive galaxies at each epoch that we look. But what we've been able to do is measure the cold component through the emission line of carbon monoxide. Now, what we really want to probe is molecular hydrogen, but because molecular hydrogen has no real permanent dipole moment, it's very hard to observe H2 directly, except if you have very excited, electronically excited states, or it doesn't, in typical 10 to 30 K gas, you don't, it's not possible to observe molecular hydrogen directly. So we observe something whose abundance we think we know, and through a very complicated process that I'm happy to talk to you after the talk about, we then get an assessment of the molecular mass by observing this CO emission. So we've been able to do this in about 60 galaxies now, probing similar but more massive galaxies than we can do with SINs. And we're in very early days with these kinds of observations, but I'll point out that in 2010, we had basically 3. And so in the last couple of years, we've been able to improve our statistics, as it were, by more than, by several orders of magnitude, or more than an order of magnitude. So we have a detection rate, in fact, of about 85%, and it's comparable to the VLT. To get the best data, we need to spend about a day per object. It's slow, but this will improve as we get better sensitivity. These are typical spectra that we get in at slightly lower redshift now, at redshift 1, whereas most of the H-alpha observations are done at redshift 2, most of our CO observations are done at redshift 1, we also can derive these velocity fields. We see that the CO also is typically located in extended disks in the bulk of our sources. We're at resolutions of about 4 kiloparsecs, so about 3 times worse than what our adaptive optics are giving us at Symphony. But we are able to derive the first rotation curves to compute the kinematical properties of these galaxies. We're also finding typical rotation to dispersion ratios of about 6 to 8, similar to what we're seeing in the H-alpha measurements. Now, that's important because a lot of people, the ionized gas can do lots of stuff, and I'll show you in a few minutes, it can be blown out in giant stellar winds, and so you might say, oh, but the reason it looks so turbulent is because you're not really measuring the bulk motions. But we're seeing the same thing in the cold molecular gas, which makes up the bulk of the mass of the interstellar medium, and in fact, in the few cases where we can make the measurements in both lines, we're seeing very consistent results, and that's something that we'll spend a lot of time on in the future. So, I've alluded to the fact that early universe galaxies have a lot of gas, but I haven't actually told you how we know that. It's been predicted for a long time that they should. Now, with this survey, we've measured that, in fact, they do. And in fact, we've measured that in 2 samples, one at redshift 1 and one at redshift 2, we're finding that mean molecular gas fractions in these 2 redshifts are on the order of a half. And by gas fraction, I mean it's a gas mass divided by a baryonic mass, gas plus stellar mass. And so half the galaxy, half the baryons in the galaxy are still in stuff that hasn't yet formed into stars. That's what we think. We're also finding, And this has been known in the local universe that the gas fractions, as you go up, if you plot gas fraction as a function of stellar mass, that you find that the gas fractions decrease as you go up in stellar mass. Now, the high redshift points are the red and blue ones. The low redshift points scaled to the scale to the same gas fraction. You see the trends are very similar. What this tells you is that this, you know, this is again an indication of this. Something's happening at these high masses that basically either use up the gas or blow it up. So we're seeing this at all redshifts, actually. A point to keep in mind for a few minutes from now is that we think that one of the things that was surprising to us, in fact, is that the gas fractions are equally high at both redshift 1 and 2, although you would expect, based on the accretion rates, they should drop off. And what we think might be happening, although this is speculation, is that feedback from star formation, that is, the star formation is driving these stellar winds, which basically takes some parcel of the gas out of play for a while. It doesn't quite eject it from the galaxy all the time. It can leave it, you know, such that it can rain back at a later time and be available to form stars again. And this may be playing a role, but it's a big question. That's something we'll spend a lot of time on in the future. What we're also seeing then is, I measured these gas fractions. If you compare with the local universe measurements of gas fractions and a few very sparse measurements at intermediate measurements, excuse me, you see that we're starting to see this cosmic evolution of molecular gas fraction, which in fact mimics what we know about the evolution of star formation, or in this case, we divide star formation by stellar mass, and you see that the two are in pretty good agreement with each other. Okay, one of the other things we wanted to calibrate in our gas observations of these early universe galaxies is we know from studies in the local universe, from seminal work that was done by Rob Kennicott in the 90s, that there's a very well-defined relationship between star formation rate and gas mass. It's kind of intuitive. So if you think stars form from cold molecular gas, you expect there to be a relationship. There's a roughly linear or slightly sublinear relationship between these two quantities. And one of the things that people, since it's so time-consuming to measure gas masses directly, people take this relationship, apply it to galaxies, and then by sort of inference, get a high gas fraction. And so what our sample now has allowed us to do is for the first time to try to calibrate that, and that's what's shown in this plot. So in gray, we show the relationship for just a few galaxies, just to make it not too messy, star formation versus molecular gas surface density, and that's the relationship at low redshift. And here in blue and green are the points for the high redshift. What you see is that it is, at least in the limited samples that we have so far, we're seeing also a roughly linear relationship between star formation rate and molecular gas surface density. What you can do then, if you divide this by this, you come up with what's called a depletion time. That is the gas mass divided by the star formation rate, or, you know, how much time would it take to take all the gas that you have, and at the current star formation rate, how much would it take to deplete it? And in the local universe, we know that that's about 1 to 2 gigayears. Now, the universe is much older than 1 to 2 gigayears, so that already tells you that something must have been, there must be replenishment of gas. Otherwise, we should never see a galaxy like the Milky Way that still has gas in it, but we do. At high redshift, it's even more extreme. We find depletion scales of about 600 megayears, or 0.6 gigayears. So this plot, the fact that you have this linear relationship with these depletion time scales, tells you already that you must be accreting gas. So this again is more support for this more equilibrium framework. So what I've told you so far is that galaxies at high redshift are gas rich, uncertainties in the measurements, and we'll try in the future to pin down those measurements much better. I've told you that they're very turbulent, and I've also, I think, showed you in various things that you tend to see lots of clumps of emission. Now, I want to spend the last bit of the talk, I have, I guess, a little bit of time left, on talking about these clumps and what we think is happening and how this may indicate how galaxies are evolving from high redshift to galaxies that look like they do in the local universe. So what we think we have is, because these high gas fractions, we think we have a situation at high redshift where basically the entire galaxy is marginally unstable to global gravitational collapse. And you measure that by this thing called a Toomer-Q parameter. That it's a stability formalism that Alar Toomer in the early 60s developed, where basically you measure this Q parameter, which is dependent on things like the velocity dispersion over the rotational velocity. And it's also a function of the, which then turns out to be a function of the gas fraction. And you're in a you talk about unstable galaxies due to unstable galaxies that can... that are globally unstable if you have this parameter less than one. And you can see that in this framework, the bulk of this particular galaxy, especially in the regions of these bright clumps, are unstable to collapse. And what we think we're seeing is that this is the largest fragmentation size scale to this collapse. So these clumps are genes lengths or tumor lengths in this formalism. You expect the largest fragmentation scales to be on the order of a kiloparsec in size radius. And actually, when you measure the sizes of some of these bright clumps, that's exactly what you see. So these clumps may be these largest fragmentation scales that happen at high redshift. And those are, not that we don't see any we do see giant star-forming regions at low redshift, but these things are much, much brighter. They can form stars up just one of those clumps. The brightest of those clumps can be forming stars at about 40 solar masses per year. So, already 10 times what the Milky Way is forming over its entire disk. They can be massive. And so these are this largest... fragmentation scales are scaled up from what we know in the local universe due to the fact that the gas fractions are higher, and also that results in the fact that the interstellar gas pressure is also higher. So what happens to these clumps? Now, there have been lots of people who say this is how you actually can form a galaxy. If you have this sort of this puffy disk and you have these this gravitationally unstable mode of clump formation, these clumps can then transport due to either viscous torques, if it's for the smooth part of the gas, or other gravitational torques, and slowly transport themselves into the center of the galaxy to form either just the spheroidal component of a disk-like galaxy, or actually even form a spheroidal galaxy itself. Now, those timescales for what we call a secular evolution timescale, those timescales depend again on this ratio V over sigma, so what the rotational support versus the turbulent, the pressure support is. Now, at redshift zero, this is a very inefficient process, because V over sigma in a typical disk galaxy at redshift zero is about 10 to 20. And so it takes 5 to 10 gigayears for this kind of a process to be effective. But at high redshift, it's actually it's only a few hundred million years. And so you can actually take galaxies and evolve them on very short timescales into the kinds of things we see today, using this more secular process rather than a merger process. Now, the caveat is, though, but that only will work if these clumps survive. And this is where then this more, you know, so what if these clumps break up due to the fact that they're forming stars at, you know, 10 to 40 solar masses per year, they might blow themselves apart. And so some of them probably do make it to the center. Some of the most massive ones, in fact, probably don't. And I'll show you some evidence for that as well. But this may be an important phase of rapid evolution at this peak epoch of galaxy formation. Now, our H-alpha observations, because we have such good spatial and spectral resolution, we're able to get very good line profiles. And so from this galaxy, again, we measure the narrow part of the line profile, which is due to the star formation. But then you see these broad blue-shifted wings. Now, those broad blue-shifted wings are indicative of outflow, because you're seeing the stuff coming towards you. The stuff on the other side of the outflow is probably obscured by the galaxy itself. And so the fact that these wings are somewhat asymmetric gives you an indication that what you're seeing here is outflow. Now, if you assume that this is just standard photoionization, you can get outflow rates that have some uncertainties associated with them. But we measure outflow rates that are on the order of 1 to 10 times the star formation rate in the clump. What this tells you is that a lot of gas in these can be ejected in these winds. We also can measure an outflow velocity of these from the wings, which says that, and we find that it, typically, given the masses of the galaxies, that the outflow velocities can be on the order of the escape velocity. So a lot of it could end up leaving the galaxy. Some of it may stay. What this says, then, is that in the most active, the clump like this one that has the highest, you know, really high star formation rate, the lifetimes of these clumps might actually only be a few hundred million years. So they may actually dissipate before they make it to the center. That doesn't say that some stuff will not go to the center, but probably not all of these things will make it all the way to the center. So that's sort of what I wanted to. So I hope I've given you a feeling for, by making these more detailed measurements, we have a handle on the star formation, what we think the star formation is doing. We have a handle, I think, we're starting to get a handle on the gas reservoirs. We're starting to get a handle on these feedback processes that may, you know, take gas out of play from forming futures, immediately out of play from forming stars. The thing we don't have yet is a real handle on the stuff coming in. I think that's our biggest open question. So I'd just like to leave you with a summary, sort of three takeaway points. Most of the galaxies that we've looked at, these massive star-forming galaxies at redshifts 2 or 1 to 2, are clumpy turbulent disks and that seem to be regular, just rotating galaxies. Only about a third of the ones that we've observed look like they have undergone sort of a major catastrophic merger event. The massive galaxies are 5 to 10 times more gas-rich than galaxies in the local universe. They have a very short gas depletion time, which means that you have to have continuous stuff coming in over the lifetime of the galaxy. We're starting to observe these powerful outflows driven from these star-forming clumps. These winds have a lot of mass in them, and they probably are key to enrich the what's called the circumgalactic medium, so the gaseous medium surrounding galaxies. They're probably also key in keeping galaxies gas-rich, and they also probably are controlling how much stuff gets to the center to form a central bulge. So those are the summaries. I hope I've also given you a feeling that there's a lot of things that are open that we don't know the answers to. That I think I know I've presented this in an overly simplistic way. I just wanted to give you a feeling for the kinds of questions we're trying to address with these data and for what we think we've learned, but there are a lot of big question marks after each one of those conclusions. So I don't want you to think that we know everything, because we really don't. We have these beautiful instruments now, the VLT. Of course, we're just starting to make observations with the ALMA telescope and the submillimeter. I would also like to mention that the IRAM Observatory, the three partners, the Max Planck Gesellschaft, the CNRS in France, and the IGN in Spain, are funding now an expansion of our little array as well to double the collecting area. And not that it will be, you know, it will not be as big as ALMA, but for doing surveys of galaxies, it's going to be a very powerful instrument in the future. And of course, with ESO, ESO will hopefully have its giant 40-meter telescope, the ELT, and I think these are the questions that are going to be important for these facilities in the future now. So can we need to try to track this accretion history. How do galaxies then stop forming stars? We see that they do it, we just don't know how. And something I didn't talk about in this talk was when and how do massive black holes grow at the centers of galaxies, and how do those black holes then affect the hosts that they in which they live? So, on that, I'd like to stop. There's lots to do, and that will keep lots of people very busy. So, thank you again. What's that?
The slide just before the summary slide.
Just before. This one?
Yeah,
there's a peak on the right. Ah, yeah, I didn't mention. This is the nitrogen. This is doubly ionized nitrogen. This is a nitrogen line, which actually this is a very important diagnostic to give you an indication of the metal enrichment of the galaxy as well. But I didn't have time to go into all the various things that, yeah, so we have multiple information here. This is the hydrogen line. This here is actually a nitrogen line. Well, you have to make all kinds of assumptions about what is ionizing the H-alpha, and this is the big uncertainty. If you assume that it's just the star formation, right, and it's a wind that's from the star formation or from the supernovae, then this is the assumption to derive these outflow rates. There's probably, there can also be something where collisions play an important role because of shocks, and that is harder to get a handle on. And so these could be, these are uncertain estimates.
Linda, I'd like to pick up on your second question on the last slide.
I don't know that we've looked hard enough. The galaxies at the very massive end, where I think we'll see the most obvious clues, are still somewhat rare, and we haven't looked at those in the greatest detail, either with H-alpha or with CO. I mean, that's certainly something I think we should do with ALMA, with CO, is to pick something that you think should be just about to shut itself off, should be quenching itself, and to see if we see some kind of a signature. whether it's a massive, you know, some kind of an inflow or an outflow, whatever, we, yeah, I agree. I think the theorists would say they predicted everything. I would, right? I don't know. But I think the various formalisms that, you know, the galaxy formation models, based on the accretion rates, would say you have to have a high, you have to have a lot of gas in these galaxies. You have to. But we hadn't seen it. We weren't able to see it until just recently because we didn't have the sensitivity to see it. So there are some discrepancies between what we're actually seeing and what people are predicting in terms of the amounts of things. Whether or not that's because there's the simulations have made some simple assumptions, or whether it's because our observations also make lots of assumptions. It's probably both, but I'm actually surprised that they agree as well as they do, given how many assumptions go into these things. And so certainly from both sides, I know the people who are working on galaxy simulations are trying to put more realistic physics of things like star formation, which is a very complicated process. I mean, Michael Meyer, who's here, will tell you he, of course, we don't even understand it in our own galaxy, and you guys are trying to put in some global recipe. It's crazy, but okay, we do it. So the simulators are trying to put in more realistic physics, and the observers are trying to really pin down what their uncertainties are, and hopefully, in the, you know, we'll get there. But
there are no more urgent questions. I would love to thank Linda again for this opportunity.